So today we'll start with the first topic, which is language processors. We had already taken an initial class, introductory class, on 12th March, and this will be a continuation of the same. So the topics which we'll go through today are fundamentals of language processing and specification, evolution of system software and operating systems, and lastly facilities and functions of OS from the user's viewpoint. Right. So the topics that we have already covered for the module 1 are introduction to system programming, evolution of the individual components, and in detail discussion about the components themselves, that is assembler, loader, macro, compiler, etc. Right. So all of these details are already available in the notes that we have shared. Let's move on to the new topics today. So the language processing, fundamentals of language processing, it consists of two phases. The first one is called the analysis phase, and the input program is also known as the source program. Now the second phase is known as the synthesis, and synthesis will lead to the generation of the target program. Right. There are specific components or specific parts of each phase, and we will go through each of those parts. We'll try to understand how the analysis phase goes and how the synthesis phase goes. The analysis phase has three rules. Right. The first one is the lexical rule. The lexical rule governs the formation of valid lexical units in the source language. Then comes the syntax rules. It governs the formation of valid statements, that is whether a statement is completely valid or not in the source language. And lastly, there's the semantic rules, which associates a meaning with valid statements in the source language. So these three rules together make up the first phase, which is the analysis phase. Right. Let's take an example. Let's consider the simple statement percentage marks equal to marks into 100 by total marks. Right. So the lexical analysis phase for this particular statement will determine that equal to, asterisk, and by, these are three operators. Right. 100 is a constant value, and the remaining strings, that is percentage marks, marks, and total marks, these will be identifiers. So these are the variables, that is the identifiers. Right. This is how the lexical analysis phase works. During syntax analysis, it will identify the statement. What is the type of statement? Right. What is the type of statement that can be determined from this given input? So the type of statement here is an assignment statement. In this type of assignment statement, the percentage marks is identified on the LHS. And the expression on the RHS, that is marks into 100 by total marks, marks into 100 by total marks, that is the expression on the right hand side. So this expression, its value is being assigned to the LHS, that is to percentage underscore marks. That is what the syntax analysis phase does. It identifies the statement, right? What type of statement it is. Finally, semantic analysis determines the meaning of the statement as assignment of marks into 100 by total marks to percentage underscore marks. Right. So this semantic analysis will denote the special meaning to the identification of statement as done by syntax analysis. Right. This is how the analysis phase works. Next comes the synthesis phase. Now this particular phase is concerned with construction of target language statement with the same meaning as source language statement. So whatever the input source code the user has given, the target language statements that the synthesis phase generates must be matching, must be relevant with the source language. I cannot generate a program with a different meaning, right? Anyway, the synthesis phase has to mandatorily perform two activities. The first one is the creation of data structures in the target program, which is also known as memory allocation. So whatever my target program requires in the memory, whatever data, variables, identifiers I use, right? They need some memory space. They need to be given certain memory, right? So the memory allocation is the first job of synthesis phase. The second job is the generation of the target code itself, that is known as code generation step, right? Okay. Language processing now consists of both phases, right? So a language processor, if you can go through the block diagram, we'll find that a language processor consists of two phases, the analysis phase and the synthesis phase. Now the source program is given as input to the analysis phase, and it generates some errors. If there are errors, the errors are shown, right? If not, then we move on to the synthesis phase. Again, in this case, there is a scope of generating errors. If there are no errors, then we move on to the target program. So this is my input. this is my output. The source program is the input, the target program is the output, right? So a very basic representation of language processing using a block diagram is given here. Now that is one thing that we need to note. The analysis phase is not immediately followed by the synthesis phase. This is very important, right? The analysis phase is not immediately followed by the synthesis phase. One of the main factors is forward reference, right? We'll come to this in a short time. One of the main factors why analysis phase is not immediately followed by the synthesis phase is forward reference. Now what is forward reference? Forward reference means we are referring to an entity before its definition. We are referring to an entity before its definition in the program. For example, we are using a variable in a program before a value is being assigned to it, right? So these sort of problems can creep up, especially when we are working with function definitions, right? Multiple times there are function definitions where we are calling the function first and then we are defining it, right, outside the program. So there are lots of such scopes where forward reference needs to be taken care of. So anyway, there are two passes of processing, right? So the whole point of going through forward reference is to understand that analysis phase does not directly precede synthesis phase. There is something in between. Now the processing, the language processing, goes through two passes. There is pass one and pass two. What pass one does is, pass one performs analysis of the source program. It notes the relevant information and it generates some output. That output is used by the pass two. It performs synthesis of the target program, right? So the output of pass one is known as the intermediate representation. It is also referred to as IR. So this IR is gathered or is generated by pass one and it is used as input to the second pass for synthesis. So the block diagram that we had here for language processing can be modified to this, right? Processing with intermediate representation. In this case, the language processor remains the same. The source program is fed to analysis phase. It generates an intermediate representation when there are no errors. So it does not directly feed the output to synthesis phase. The intermediate representation is then fed to synthesis phase, where it is modified to a target program. The target program is synthesized. So this step of intermediate representation enables memory efficiency and processing efficiency both. It is also making the whole process much easier, right? So this is the problem of forward reference that can be solved by using the concept of a intermediate representation, right? So with this we come to the end of the fundamental of language processing and specification part, right? The next part we move on to is evolution of system software and operating systems. So in the early days, when the PCs became popular, there were simple batch processing systems, right? In batch processing systems, the whole memory that was available for the user that could be allocated to a single program only. We could not allocate different programs. We could not run different programs on the same memory location, right? So memory allocated to a single program. Now, in most cases, what happened was the program's memory requirement was less than the total memory, right? And in these cases, the memory was wasted. So memory is a resource for the machine, right? So as a resource, the memory was wasted. Now, this problem of batch systems was reduced or it was overcome by the use of multi-programming operating systems. So people started using multi-programming operating systems. Now, multi-programming operating systems, their specialty is that they allow multiple programs to reside in separate areas of the memory. So if I have a huge memory space, I'll allow multiple programs to reside in separate areas. So there's no overlap between them, there's no collision, and they can independently work, right? Now, there can be two types of multi-programming approaches. One is multi-programming with fixed task, MFT. In this solution, each program is given a fixed portion of memory. Let there be n number of programs, and these n number of programs will each get a fixed size of memory, right? That is multi-programming with fixed task. The second solution is multi-programming with variable tasks, MVT. In this solution, each program is given a variable size of memory as required. So as per the requirement of each program, a variable size of memory can be provided in MVT, right? Now, even in partition memory allocation, some memory is wasted. Some memory is wasted in every partition, right? So how do I reduce this fragmentation? this problem is known as fragmentation. The unused portion of memory is known as a fragment, and this phenomenon is called fragmentation, right? We have already gone through these topics in OS. We are just trying to understand the same essence here in system programming, right? So to minimize fragmentation, there are two solutions. First one is relocatable partition. Relocatable partition allows the use of addresses of the unused memory location across partitions together as a new partition memory, which means if I have several partitions where some address spaces are unused, where some memory locations are unused, I can group together those address spaces and I can use them together as a single partition, as a single new partition, right? This system is known as a relocatable partition system. The other solution, which we are familiar with already, is known as paging. In paging, the programs are divided into equal size parts called blocks, The programs are divided into equal size parts called pages, and the memory is divided into equal size portions called blocks. Now, during execution, the pages are loaded into the blocks. This is how paging works. Now, paging has two types. One is called simple paging. In simple paging, for a program to be in execution, all the pages of the program need to be in memory before execution. Otherwise, the program cannot be executed, right? So if a program has 5 pages, let's say, then in order to execute the program, I need to make sure that all the 5 pages of the program are loaded into the blocks of the memory. Otherwise, I cannot execute the program. This is the concept of simple paging. The second concept is called demand paging. It's a bit more efficient than simple paging, as it enables program execution without the presence of all the pages of program in the memory, right? So if my program has 5 pages, I can simply begin the execution using page number 1 by loading it in a block in memory, right? I do not need to load 1 through 5, all the 5 pages in memory for beginning execution. As and when I require, I can load individual pages to the memory, right? This is known as demand paging. So on demand, I am loading the pages of the program to the blocks in memory. So these are the two types of paging concepts, simple paging and demand paging. Now with this, we come to the end of the evolution of system software and OS. The last part is facilities and functions of OS from user's viewpoint, right? So as an end user, every person has specific requirements or expectations from the operating system, right? So in terms of functionalities, we expect every OS to perform the following, right? Job sequencing, scheduling, how and when the jobs will be performed, in what order, right? That sequencing has to be ensured by the OS. Input-output programming, the OS has to enable the user input and output operations. It has to guide us, right? It has to provide us with protection from the user and of particular user from other users, right? So an OS has to ensure that the user can't perform any action which compromises its own critical functionality. Also, it has to ensure that the job or the work by any one user is not harmed or is not compromised by any other user, right? So these security functions are also essential for any operating system. Secondary storage management, so that the user can use the secondary storage, namely the hard disk drive, as and when required. And last but not the least, the OS has to ensure that there is some capability of error handling. So if there is any exceptional situation, then the OS can handle that, right? The user can work through it. Now these are the functions of any operating system. Next we come to the facilities from the user viewpoint. So does not mean that every OS has to have these facilities, but it's a fact that most modern OSs come with almost all of these facilities, right? Pre-included. So there has to be some assemblers, there has to be compilers, right? There are Fortran, COBOL, nowadays C, C++. The OS has to, you know, come with subroutine libraries like sine, cosine, sqrt, whichever we use with certain compilers. It has to provide us with linkage editors, loaders, etc. There have to be some utility routines such as sort, merge, etc. There has to be some application packages for application software, right? So that we can work with application softwares. There has to be some debugging facilities. Lastly, we come to data management, file processing capability, right? These can be treated as facilities of the OS. And management of system hardware. This is a very critical facility that the OS provides us, right? So the previous one was the functions from the user viewpoint. What does the user expect of an OS? And this one is the facilities that a OS is supposed to provide the user with, right? So at any point of the discussion, if you feel you wish to go through it again, you can simply pause the video, go through the slide, right, and you can continue. So with this we come to the end of module 1 as part of syllabus, right? So again I repeat myself, this is the continuation of the lecture we had on 12th March, right? And this whole video is going through the remaining part of module 1. The next lecture will contain the details of the syllabus from module 2. We'll start with the syllabus from module 2, right? For references, you can always go through the notes that I've already provided, right? And there's a systems programming book by John Donovan. You can also go through it. In case you have any queries, you can always come to me. You can always mail to me, right? You know my email ID. Take care. We'll meet next, right?